So last month I ranked all of the MCU directors, so today I'm gonna stop and rank all six DCU directors from the worst to the best. Hi, my name is Sean Chandler, and I started this channel because I was driving everyone around me crazy talking about movies way too much. If you can relate, you're probably in the right place and consider clicking that subscribe button. With that in mind, go ahead and join me down below in the comment section. Share your ranking of the DCEU directors. One final thing before I get started, people frequently ask me where I get my posters as well as my Funkos and what equipment I use for my videos. There's a link down below and it'll take you to a list of most of my stuff and where you can pick it up as well. With that said, let's get started. In last place is Joss Whedon. Now, technically, he is not a credited director on any of the DCEU films, but everybody knows he's the one that finished Justice League. He did the rewrites, he did the reshoots, and he's the one that spent the last 6 months putting the film together. I don't think he was a good fit to replace Zack Snyder, as their styles are so wildly different. And as well, I kind of think he was given an impossible task because of just how much the WB was micromanaging everything. So I don't really hold this movie against him, but Justice League is a directorial disaster. The storytelling is clunky. A big part of that is because it's the product of two plus directors, being that you had Zack Snyder and Joss Whedon, plus the WB micromanaging the entire thing and dictating a 2 hour runtime. And that has consequences on storytelling. The acting is dull and lifeless for the most part. The special effects don't really work very well. Once again, a lot of that is because the WB mandated a release date that didn't give them enough time to finish the special effects. I think the movie looks atrocious. It's overprocessed. It's very obvious which sequences were Joss Whedon reshoots because of the dialogue inside of them, because of the look of them, because of the way Ben Affleck looks in general. This is a movie that feels directorially out of control. All the things that the director is supposed to direct and make into a cohesive unit, they are all over the place. Coming in at number five is David Ayer. I actually think that directorially speaking, he does a pretty good job with certain elements with this film. One of the most important roles of a director is the performances, and I think the cast here are perfectly fine. Some of them are really good, and so in that role, he did a great job. I also think the tone is pretty consistent throughout the film, and it feels right given the subject matter. However, another responsibility of the director is the story and the storytelling, and they are a disaster. Now, it's tough to know how much of that is the responsibility of his script, which they only gave him 6 weeks to write, his directing of the principal photography, and the movie being reworked in the editing process and reshot by the studio. But as you watch the movie, the first 30 minutes, it's just introducing characters using voiceover, flashbacks, and classic rock music. As you move into the body of the film, he starts making very rookie mistakes. He repeats multiple plot beats, such as helicopter crashes and Amanda Waller being rescued. The story gets really clunky, as if he's never directed a movie before. Which he has directed some really good movies before this. But once again, it's tough to know how much you blame on him and how much you blame on the studio for all their meddling, but the end result is very amateurish in the handling of its story. Number four is Zack Snyder. To be clear, I'm actually a very big fan of a lot of Zack Snyder's work. I think he is excellent with action. He has a very distinct visual style, and he's actually able to kind of explore certain types of themes that are primal in nature very well. Add to that, Man of Steel is my favorite film inside of the DCEU, and a lot of that goes back to the specific sentiments that he brought to the material, his kind of rich themes inside of a lot of it, and his exploration of this character that I loved, and the way that he was able to visualize a 21st century Superman. Big fan. But what I don't think he's necessarily great at is handling lots of big, complex storylines. And that's kind of what happened with Batman v Superman. And his weaknesses start to come out as the film gets weighed down by Lex Luthor's overly complex plan, trying to shoehorn in a Justice League setup movie. And suddenly it's just bogged down with way too much stuff going on. And then you continue from there into Justice League. And I think what happened with that movie is that he had this big vision. There was a very Zack Snyder type vision. The studio tried to squish it down on him before he even started shooting it. And then it was redone by Joss Whedon. And you just get to kind of get this Frankenstein monster of a movie. I know there's a lot of people really interested in seeing the Zack Snyder cut. I'm really not all that interested because even before he started filming, they'd already taken his vision from two movies down to one. And so I think his vision was compromised before they said action for the first time. Real quick, before I give you my top three, remember to share your ranking down below in the comment section. Let's keep it respectful. We can disagree, but we don't have to be jerks to one another. My list isn't the right list. It's just my list, and I would love to hear yours. After this video, check out this playlist up above with all of my up-to-date rankings of the DCU. I've updated the films, the heroes, the villains, all that fun stuff has been done in the last month. So if you enjoyed this video, you should check that one out. In third place is James Wan. This is another director that I'm a big fan of outside of his work inside of the DCU, and I thought he did a very fine job with Aquaman itself. Some of my favorite things about this movie is that he does these long takes for the action. You can see everything happening. Even when you have Nicole Kidman fighting inside of a house, which is very close quarters, he found a way to be able to do these long takes, spinning around, chases through these cities on the rooftop, all of it handled very cool. Even if as you move into the big CGI battles, it's vibrant, it's exciting. Some people weren't crazy about how much CGI there was. I thought that it fit the film that they were making and the fact that we're looking at these big lobster creatures anyway. I don't mind that it's all CGI. For the most part, I thought he had a pretty good handle on this big epic story. In this one, you get the emotions of the royalty and the struggle of Arthur Curry. You also get the exciting action sequences. There's a little bit of terror as you move into the trench, but all of it felt like one cohesive movie. Now, where I thought that he was a little bit weaker is that I didn't feel like he trusted his script in his story, and so it felt like he needed to kind of throw in too many cheap jokes and too much pop music to just try and spice things up and add entertainment into the mix. Now, it's mildly amusing when you have characters eating roses and Jason Momoa going, "Why didn't I just pee on it?" But at a certain point in time, you can see the tricks that they're using here, and they're playing to the lowest common denominator. When every time I've watched this movie and they cut to Africa and that Pitbull cover of the song Africa starts playing, it just pulls me right out of the movie. And that goes back to him as a director, I don't think, trusting the film that he was making and just feeling that he needed to spice things up. Our runner-up is David Sandberg for Shazam. And interesting enough, this is another alumni of the Conjuring franchise. And the way the universe played out, the two guys that came from directing horror movies made the two lighthearted films inside of the DCEU. In general, I thought he did a really great job with this material in grounding it in human emotions, in tying it, like exploring these themes about family, relationships, dynamic, and making that the heart of the movie rather than all the fantastical wizard superhero stuff. When I watched this movie a second time, the thing that stuck out to me is just how much I was resonating with all of the adopted foster care elements of the story and how much I cared about all of those characters. I actually like the way they visualized the super speed and a lot of the powers and stuff like that. As you see Shazam like in a park, like flying across the parking lot to try and rescue someone, I think that looks really cool the way that it's visualized. Where this one got knocked back for me is that it was tonally uneven to an incredibly frustrating level. Some of my friends were like, oh, it's way too much of like, just like a little kid movie. Like, I bet kids would like it. And then as a parent, I'm like, I wish I could take my kids to go see this one, but the boardroom scene, some of the stuff in the finale with the seven deadly sins, I couldn't take my children to go see that stuff. I have a hard time understanding even who their target audience was because it seems like there's a gap between these two groups of people. He was so close to being my number one, and then he just let a couple of things out of control and knocked him back to second. But coming in first place is Patty Jenkins. She was given a very difficult task in attempting to bring a very weird character whose costume doesn't necessarily lend itself very well to a serious superhero film. Some of her backstory is kind of odd to put in the same universe as Man of Steel and what they did in that original film. And Patty Jenkins found a way to take a character that has a lasso, that has an invisible jet, that runs around in a US flag swimsuit, and ground it and actually explore ideas about war, man's inhumanity to man. To make a film like this work, she had to juggle a whole lot of balls, and she was able to do it and make a very cohesive film where all the elements feel right. It feels like a natural extension of the previous films inside of the DCEU. It feels like its own film in and of itself. It's entertaining in its own right. You love the characters. You're excited throughout the film. The problem that I've always had with this film is that it kind of runs a bit out of steam as you run into the third act, but a lot of that kind of goes back to the script. It's not so much that she goes off the rails with what she did with things, but the script itself gets very talky and stretches things out a little bit too much. Some of that is on her shoulders. She should have tried to tighten that up a little bit. But in general, at this moment, I think she has the best track record directing inside of the DCEU. So Patty Jenkins comes in at number one. Remember to check out that playlist right over there with all of my DCEU rankings. You can check out that link down below to discover where I get my posters, my Funkos, all of that fun stuff. Thank you so much for watching, and keep talking movies too much.